Okay, Michael, so here's this theorem that you so desperately wanted. You ready?
Yep.
I'm going to read it to you because you can't read. In a two-player, zero-sum, deterministic game of perfect information, minimax equals maximin.
All right, you told us what minimax was, but you didn't tell us what maximin was.
Well, maximin is like minimax, except the other way around. So A is trying to, you know, one side is trying to minimize the maximum, and the other side is trying to maximize the minimum. It's okay. Exactly what we described before. It just depends upon whether you're looking at it from A's point of view or B's point of view.
Oh, I see. Like, do you choose a column first or do you choose a row first?
Exactly. So whether you go A first followed by B or B first followed by A, you're going to end up in the same with the same result. And that, more importantly, or at least as importantly, there always exists an optimal pure strategy for each player. In other words, you can solve those games and you know what the answer is. Once you write down the matrix, you just do minimax or you do maximin, and you end up with the proper answer. And now you know what the optimal players would do. Now, there's a subtlety here, which I got it a little bit in the previous slide when I talked about rational agents. And what we're sort of assuming in everything that we discuss here is that people are always trying to maximize their rewards, okay? So we define the reinforcement learning problem that way. My goal is to find a policy that maximizes my long-term expected reward. You know, so I'm trying to get the best reward that I can. And what you're assuming here is that everyone else is doing the same thing, and they're assuming that everyone else is doing the same thing.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
It does, though. I'm a little bit stuck on this word optimal at the moment.
Right. Well, that's what I'm trying to get at, actually, that optimal here really means I'm maximizing the reward that I can get, and I'm assuming everyone else is doing the same thing. And I'm assuming that they're assuming that everyone else is doing the same thing.
So I guess I'm wondering whether this theorem is vacuous in the sense that are we defining optimal to be minimax?
What we're defining optimal to be, I think. So that's a good question. I think I would unroll the vacuousness one level by saying this: optimal here basically has to be optimal with respect to what? And the respect to what here is the underlying assumption that everyone is trying to maximize their rewards and that everyone knows this. So in a world where you have perfect information, it's zero sum, then the strategy of minimax and maximin give you the same answer. And that furthermore, there is always some place where the column and the row cross, the best column and the best row cross. And that is always going to be the solution to that particular game. Now, if we weren't in a two-player zero-sum deterministic game of perfect information, that might not be the case. But in a case where we're in this sort of simplest version, where everyone's being rational, that is, optimal, that is, trying to maximize their own reward and is assuming everyone else is maximizing their own reward, this is the right thing to do. Now, I've got a little weasel word here as well, which we're going to get to in a moment, which is this notion not just of a strategy, but of a pure strategy. And there's a reason why we have notions of pure strategies, because in the end, as we get more complicated, we're going to have to deal with impure strategies. Okay. But are you with me so far?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah. That basically all that stuff we did in AI with game trees and search is kind of the what you would expect people to do if they knew everything.
So I feel like I could prove this theorem in the case of trees because you just kind of compute values from the leaves up to the root.
Yeah.
And it doesn't matter. There is no notion of who goes first or who goes second. So there's just going to be one answer to that process. It's not obvious to me how to show it once you turn the tree into a matrix, that matrix, I guess because it captures the same information, it ought to be the case that this is still true, but like I'd have to sit down and kind of think it through.
No, and so to help you think it through, I guess what I would suggest is if you have the matrix, you can create a tree that's consistent with it because every row and every column represents a strategy. You don't know what that strategy is, but you can, since it's a finite matrix, you can construct a tree that is consistent with that matrix. In fact, possibly an infinite number of them, I'm not sure, but you can certainly construct at least one that is consistent with it. And then once you have the tree, you just do what you say.
Good.
All right, good. So we've got this fundamental result, and now what we're going to do is we're going to try to be a bit more interesting. But it was important to go through this because now we've got some basic vocabulary and some basic building blocks, okay?
Yep.
All right.